Hello, I'm Vivian Kamsime. Welcome to the checkpoint this week. And we are checking on police. Police has been investigating a case of aggravated robbery where thugs made off with 65 million and left a teacher dead. And a guard was injured in the case. Now, at St. Andrew Kagwa in Mukono, there has been this incident that police is still looking into and finding out what could have happened. We do sit down with the Kampala Metropolitan Deputy Spokesperson, Luke Owoyesigyire, to look at what is happening there. But also, this has been going on in other parts, both in Kampala Metropolitan area and in Impiji. We also want to know, have they recorded such cases in other areas or districts in Kampala? Kindly join me to have this discussion. Thank you. You're welcome, Afande.
Thank you very much.
You have heard what I just said.
Yes.
You have this case at St. Andrew Kagwa Senior Secondary School in Mukono, where a teacher was left dead. Thugs made off with 65 million. Then you had a guard who got injuries in that incident. Do you know who is attacking schools? Because this is not the only case where this has happened. Who is attacking our schools?
Well, one thing is certain. It is a person. There are people. It is not an animal. It is not an alien. These are people, a group of people who come in groups of 4, 5, sometimes 10, depending on how big the school or the premises they are raiding is going to be. And they look for the quickest point of attack, that is always the bursar's office, because their aim is always money and also some equipment, which are laptops and computers. In many of the cases we have registered, that is what they always do, go away with. And in this very previous case of St. Andrew, Kagwa. It is unfortunate we lost her life, but investigations are ongoing to ascertain which person is or which people are actually behind this. We made some few arrests, of course, starting from the teachers within the school, whom we questioned about what exactly happened. Some just ignored the whole thing while it was happening and informed police later, after. When there was a big gap on when the incident happened and when we were informed about the incident. So
why that gap?
So we believe that was the negligence of the adults and the administrators of the school, and we somehow questioned them about that. But also we know they are not behind this. We've gotten information from members of the public, made a few arrests here and there.
How many have you arrested?
So far, we have 3 suspects in our custody. We even made some recoveries of suspected stolen items, but the school confirms those are not their items. We recovered some mattresses, some equipment, phones within the areas of Nagalama, but the school confirmed that those are not their items. However, we are following up on some leads of people whom we know could be behind this kind of act, and we shall be giving you that information if it is successful, but since I don't want to jeopardize with the ongoing investigation.
You see, sir, from what you have said, a number of questions arise. For example, who do these items belong to? Had those people already reported cases at your police stations? Do you know about that?
As in the items recovered?
Yes, the mattresses, because you said that even though you recovered them, they don't belong to St. Andrew's Kagwa.
They are suspected to be stolen. Until we confirm that someone is claiming for them, that is when we can say they are stolen. But I was trying to give you the update that is there. There are ongoing operations to see that we get on top of the situation, like making arrests and making sure that we understand who exactly is behind this. I'm not saying the people that were arrested are actually the ones behind this. It will only be confirmed with the items we recover and also statements from the witnesses that could have seen their faces.
So when you say they are arrested, it means as we speak now they are in police cells?
Yes, they are. We have some suspects in our custody.
How long does it take for you to take them to court?
It is a process. Mm. It is a process. With all the processing, we take them to court as long as we have enough evidence against them.
So you're still doing evidence gathering?
Yes.
As we speak now?
Yes.
There have also been other such cases around Kampala metropolitan area. There's also been an incident in Mpiji, also at Kasau Secondary School in Mukono. Yes.
Yeah, we are investigating over 7 cases. There's that happened in Muduma, that is in Mpiji, that is being investigated by Wakiso Police Station, where they attacked one of the seminaries, a primary school, and some lay readers, reverends, were beaten badly. They got injuries, and they even destroyed the tabernacle in the process and went away with a lot of cash, close to 5 million. There were 2 incidents on neighboring schools in Mende, that is in Wakiso. All of that is still under investigation. What we promise members of the public is that in the past we have had such waves of crime where a group of criminals concentrate on a certain business. Mm-hmm. It used to be supermarkets, they elevated to petrol stations. Then they elevated to mugging foreigners on the road. Now they have resorted to schools. So we are only promising them that this is something that we'll also handle, and we shall get on top of the situation. We shall make arrests. There are very credible leads that we are following up. Of course, like I said, I can't dwell into it very much because it might jeopardize the ongoing investigation. But it is something that is in our hearts. It is something that we take very serious because, first and foremost, this is security of children at schools, wherever they are, and also a space for business. And if parents don't trust schools from protecting themselves, how will they trust them to protect their children? So we have to make sure that such businesses and the members of the public are protected in any way possible, and that is making sure that we identify who exactly is behind this. And we can only do this with the communities. In the current community engagements with the schools we're having, we are informing them to always report such suspicious people within their community, because we believe these are people who do the reconnaissance, and after doing the reconnaissance, they attack. So if there are suspicious people in your communities, the LOC1 chairman, please report these people. Because we hardly believe that people will just come out of nowhere to go and attack a school where they don't know its capabilities. And many of the security guards in these schools are only armed with batons, sometimes with a bow and arrow.
We are going to get into that question of these security guards, but just before we get there, I'm just thinking that there have been a number of cases, like you just said, or situations where police does investigations and then we never get to see reports.
No, that is not true. The reports are pretty much there. We have always held press briefings, giving daily updates on many of these
cases.
Yes,
the weekly
updates.
Updates you're talking about?
Cases and the reports, if you're much interested in it as a new vision, you can always ask for it, not to wait for the one we release every year. So if someone talking about reports, because this is something that the Inspector General of Police has dwelled into, making sure that we make reports each year that goes by.
And about particular incidences.
If
like
anyone is interested in those particular incidents, we always come out with the reports. A report that concern to the public interest. Yes. We always come out with them. Afande Nange is always communicating about a certain investigation of this caliber, and is always giving details on what they found out. So we just need, you know, but the problem we have as Ugandans is that we just dwell much on what is there currently, and then it goes away, we forget about it.
Yes, so, but the police, what you're telling us is that the police keeps those reports, and even if everyone else has forgotten and the media is not giving it as much spotlight,
someone can come out and ask for it.
And ask for that report and take a look at what exactly happened. Yes. Wow, that's a very interesting one. Also, the issue of arrest that I just talked about. You've had these... when did you arrest these culprits or thugs?
Just last week.
Because this particular incident in Mukono, the St. Andrew Kagwa Senior Secondary School, happened on Saturday. And like you have mentioned, in those 7 cases, it has been happening, more like a wave. So do you have a plan on how you're going to put these suspects in court? And
well, I believe that is not very important right now, putting suspects in court. What is very important is understanding what the problem is, who are these people behind this.
Yes.
So, like I said, I did particularly come out to say that the suspects we have, we are 100% sure that they're the ones who engaged in this activity.
Yes, that's the work of police.
That is not what I'm
saying. The work of the judiciary.
Yes, that is not... even though, put aside the work of the judiciary, I can also come and claim that the evidence we have is sufficient enough to show that these people participated in this activity. That is my work, to say that. But it is the judiciary to determine whether it is sufficient or not. And the evidence we have now, it cannot 100% prove that the suspects we have in the Mukono incidents are the ones that participated in what? In the activity. What I'm saying is this public was suspicious of persons whom they don't know in the area.
Yes.
We made a raid, made arrests, recovered some items which don't belong to the school, but these items, they are not account, the suspects cannot account for them. So there is suspicion that they could be engaged in robberies or other cases of aggravated robberies, but not specifically to what happened in Mukono.
Okay.
So that all I was trying to bring out is that we are doing something. We are responding on information.
You're studying the situation and investigating what is happening.
Yes, and responding on information from members of the public.
Okay. So I'm also wondering, besides that, the investigations and responding to members of the public, what are you doing to sensitize the schools about them being at risk?
First and foremost, we have, as Kampala Metropolitan, we have started out a proactive measure of reaching out to all the schools within Kampala Metropolitan, those we feel are a target. We've only gotten challenges with schools in Mukono and Wakiso. So we are reaching out
and
all
Mpiji.
And Mpiji. Mpiji, it is only one school in Mpiji. So we are reaching out to those schools, making sure that our officers within the Directorate of Community Liaison and also Investigation Department and also Operation reach out to these schools, educate them on what they're supposed to be doing, sharing our telephone contacts with students, because many of these schools, some students have phones. You can't avoid that. And also making sure that the teachers themselves don't hide away, don't cower whenever they're in face of this kind of attack, to always make sure that they respond through making phone calls, through organizing themselves, because these people are not very many. Well, although they move with sometimes with deadly weapons like pangas.
Yes.
So to have an organization, if you can't hire, at least they should be, because many of these schools are on acres and acres of land. So you can organize yourselves on issues to do with neighborhood watch, with the community you're in, to make sure that you identify some of the persons that are suspected to be behind these attacks, people you're suspicious of, report them to police, and also making sure that these our police officers do quite a lot of patrol in the night, especially within the areas where schools are located, to respond swiftly in case they are called upon, or to make sure that they can cover the exits or the entrances where the criminals might want to use to escape or get out of the situation in case we have responded. So we are giving them all these tactics, especially communication is key, because I believe if someone had communicated quite early about the Mkono incident, the police would have arrived quite very fast, and there would be a difference, which of course wasn't the case in the other schools, because we in the Mkono incident, we are told even students were awake, and there was a big alarm in the school from students. But from 1 to 4, no one communicated to the police. So that shows that...
That happened in the night, from 1 a.m. to 4 a.m.
No. The incident happened at 1, but we got communication at 4. So it shows that there is need for communication. If there is that line between the police and schools, if there is that line of communication between the police and the school, it is something that I believe will yield results. We have not been, I will confess, we have not been having challenges with schools. Those are some of the institutions we believe were quite protected and were ignored, I would say, by criminals. Maybe to a certain extent, the officers within the areas also became comfortable and concentrated on homes and businesses. Since schools were not under attack, but now that this kind of thing is out there, so we are trying to advise them to see that there is always a response or consideration in on how the protection thing goes within the communities we serve.
Yes, kindly talk to schools on how they can protect their cash, because they need to keep some cash on them that they used to run the school. That's like the petty cash. And they have these private guards. We are going to get into the issue of the private guards. But before they actually have the right guards, like you'll advise us, how can they put measures in place for them to have their money safe, apart from just putting it in their safe? Because as we speak right now, thieves are going with their money.
Actually, on many occasions, the money that has been taken from schools is not kept in safes. Mm-hmm. The money that is actually, in most cases, taken from these schools is money that is meant for pocket money for students. If you have over 400 students, and most of these students keep their money with you, with the administration, that will be a big amount of money that is kept with the administration. And in a few cases, they have also some small money to do the day-to-day businesses of the school. So we believe if they vise up means of making sure that they have as less cash as possible, and also making sure that at least they have some armed personnel who are alert at school. Because in most cases, these guards concentrate more on making sure that the children within the school are safe and don't escape. Ignore some of these things.
Yes,
over the security
of the
administration block and many other things.
If I may cut you short, what you're saying simply raises the question of who should be guarding in these schools. Should it be the private guards, or should we have police, like we are seeing in most of these government agencies where we have the police actually standing a guard?
Well, to be honest, it should be the private security. At the end of the day, there are a lot of businesses that are guarded by private security, and the guarding goes on well, but it depends on how many private guards are you willing to deploy. You'll find a school on 4 acres having only 2 guards. So a school on 4 acres, a criminal can always beat the security easily. And many of these schools have porous
borders. They don't have perimeter walls.
The perimeter walls are not there. They are so porous that these criminals can access the premises easily. Or if they are not porous, they have only wire meshes, which are easily cut, barbed wires, which are easily cut for the criminals to access these schools. So we need to also ascertain how many guards should a school have, depending on the size of the school.
Who does that?
The administrators can.
Who is supposed to do that?
It is the school. It is their responsibility to make sure that the children are protected, because these are private schools, and the children pay money to be guarded, to be protected. So it is the responsibility of the school. Yes.
So, and there are cases where maybe you guys do, the police does random security checks where you ascertain how many guards do you have here? Have there been any security incidents?
That is something we need to agree. In the meetings we are doing with these many schools, it is something we need to agree with the schools. If your school is big, we need to agree on the limit or on how many guards you should be having, depending on the how big your school is. If you're then also putting in place CCTV cameras, if they are there. If you don't have, if you cannot have a lot of guards, at least put their mechanisms like CCTV cameras at points you feel black spots, and there should be someone monitoring these CCTV cameras, if possible. Yes.
Okay, now besides Mpiji and the Kampala metropolitan areas, have you had cases that have been reported of such attacks on schools in the other parts of the country, maybe whatever district?
Well, I don't think there's been any incident I'm aware of. I'm only aware of those that happened in Kampala Metropolitan.
Yes. Okay. So what would you advise the parents to do in this, in case their children are facing such threats in the schools?
Well, I think the PTAs in school are very important. The PTAs in schools are very important. I think teachers, parents, and the administration of the school need to sit down and agree on how they can help each other with the security of protecting their children and students. And also the school itself, because at the end of the day, if a school is attacked, it comes back also to the parents, knowing that your child is not safe wherever they are. So having these meetings and also agreeing on what should be done around schools is very important. If it is to agree that we should get security officers, and this is the amount of money they are going to pay, they can sit down as parents and the administration and teachers and agree that they should hire or bring in guards, and if they should be armed, they agree on that, because at the end of the day, some parents are not comfortable taking their children to schools where they have armed personnel.
Yes.
Some parents are not comfortable with that. I think they can sit down and agree on that. If parents, the guards deployed should be armed or not, and how many should they be, and how do you meet the challenge of the cost of these guards, or putting an initiative in place like CCTV cameras? Should there be an increment on the development fee that is put in the school or something? So all those things should be agreed upon.
Thank you very much. We are still here talking security in schools, and when we return, we will continue with the same topic and find out also what is happening in Kampala metropolitan area to do with security. I'm Vivian Kamsimi.